Hi students, all of you good morning and good afternoon. Welcome to the class. In today's topic, we are going to discuss explanation to line emission spectrum of hydrogen. Yes, all of you know the formation of line emission spectrum of hydrogen when hydrogen gas, H2 gas, is taken in the electric discharge tube and subjected to high voltage electricity. Then the hydrogen gas molecules are first breaking down to give hydrogen atoms. And those hydrogen atoms formed, they are going to absorb energy. The electrons in the hydrogen atoms, they are going to get excited to different excited states. N is equal to 1 indicates ground state, except of this one. N is equal to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and so on. They indicate excited states of hydrogen atom. So whenever hydrogen gas is subjected to electric discharge, the formed hydrogen atoms are going to get excited. The electrons in the hydrogen atoms are going to get excited to second level or third level or fourth level or fifth level or sixth level, seventh level, and so on. Suppose the excited electrons of hydrogen atoms from any higher energy level to ground level, if they are going to get de-excited, then we can see the formation of a group of spectral lines. That series is called as Lyman series, and it is formed in UV region. Whereas if the excited electrons of the hydrogen atom from any higher energy level, they are getting de-excited to second level, then again we can see formation of a group of spectral lines that is called as Balmer series, and this is obtained in the visible region. That means these lines can be visible to the naked eye, and the first line, that is the de-excitation of electron from third level to second level, this emitted spectral line is called as H alpha line. Similarly, from fourth level to second level, this is the fourth level to second level, when the de-excitation of electron of hydrogen is going to happen, the formed emitted spectral line is called as H beta line, like that H gamma line, H delta line. So this is a series called as Balmer series, formed in visible region. Like that, if the de-excited electrons coming to third level, then we can get the series that is named as Paschen series, that is formed near of the infrared region. Like that, bracket series and the P fund series are formed. So this is the formation of light emission spectrum of hydrogen. Please once again read the answer from your GVIT material. Right, today we are going to discuss explanation to light emission spectrum of hydrogen. Yes, please just stay on. Sorry for your inconvenience. So today we are going to discuss explanation of line spectrum of hydrogen. Yes, just now we saw the line spectrum of hydrogen that is having different series: Lyman series, Balmer series, Paschen series, bracket series, and P fund series or fund series, P silent, then fund series. So if we are going to take the energy difference between any two orbits, then difference is written by delta, energy is E. So delta E is indicating the energy difference between any two orbits. Generally, I am taking as E2 minus E1. For our simplicity, I am taking delta E as E2 minus E1. Otherwise, you can take delta E as EF minus EI. Here, EF stands for energy of higher orbit. EI stands for energy of lower orbit. Otherwise, simply I can write E2. E2 means energy of higher orbit. E1 means energy of lower orbit. So all of you know, this is the formula, delta E is equal to E2 minus E1 or delta E is equal to EF minus EI. Okay, fine. According to Niels Bohr's model of hydrogen atom, Niels Bohr succeeded to calculate the energy of nth orbits of hydrogen atom. And the formula is given as En is equal to minus RH into 1 by n square joules. So from this En formula, En is equal to minus RH into 1 by n square joules, then we can calculate E2 value and E1 value. Here I am going to calculate E2 value and E1 value. Yes. First of all, I am writing En once again. Energy of nth orbit of hydrogen atom. That is equal to minus RH into 1 by n square joules. Now, what we can write? Instead of taking EF, I am taking E2. E2 is equal to minus RH into 1 by n2 square joules. E1 is equal to minus RH into 1 by n1 square joules. Yes, from these two values, what we can write now? We can write delta E value. Delta E is equal to minus RH into 1 by n2 square, because E2 minus E1. First, I am taking E2 value. Minus even value. Even value. What is even value? Minus RH into 1 by N1 square. This is the even value. Now, by taking the RH as common, Rydberg's constant. RH means Rydberg's constant. Delta E is equal to, what is delta E? The energy difference between any two orbits, that is delta E, is equal to RH into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. As energy difference, so here the units are joules. Joules. Please remember this formula. This is important for JEE level problems. No need for NEET. No need for CET. Just for JEE, please remember the formula. Delta E is equal to RH into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square joules. Okay. So this was obtained from the line emission spectrum of hydrogen. Okay. According to Niels Bohr, what is the formula to calculate the frequency of emitted spectral line? What is the formula used to calculate the frequency of emitted spectral line? That is known as Bohr's frequency rule. Once again, Bohr's frequency rule. Text me the formula. What is the formula of Bohr's frequency rule? What is the formula of Bohr's frequency rule? Can anybody answer? What is the formula of Bohr's frequency rule? Frequency is indicated by nu. Frequency is indicated by nu. Nu is equal to delta E by H. Small h. Nu frequency is equal to delta E by H. So from this formula, we can derive delta E value. So delta E is equal to H nu. So from the Bohr's frequency rule, we derived delta E is equal to H nu. And from the line emission spectrum of hydrogen, we derived delta E is equal to RH into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square joules. Now, if you observe the first equation and the second equation, suppose if it is taken as the first equation and it is taken as the second equation, here delta E is there, here also delta E is there on the left side. So then we are going to equal the two equations. Then we can write. What we can write now? H H nu is equal to H nu is equal to RH into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. Again, this is a formula important for JEE model exams. Have to remember the formulas. Here, one thing you have to understand, CDF. Yes, you will get it out. Sir, what is meant by C? C means concepts. D means definitions. And the F means formulas. If the student who is good enough in concepts, definition, and formulas, he or she will do more practices very easily. So please go through the concepts first, then try to understand the definitions and try to understand how the formulas are derived. If you understand all of this, then you have to remember one more thing. You have to remember the units of every symbol. For example, lambda is given, wavelength. What is the unit of wavelength? Either angstroms or nanometers or meters or centimeters. You have to remember the units also. Then you can solve the MCQs easily. So anyhow, from the equation 1 and equation 2, we derived the formula H nu is equal to RH into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. Now, nu, we know the nu as frequency. Nu means frequency. Frequency is known as C by lambda. Then we can write HC by lambda is equal to RH into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. Yes, my dear students, this total derivation is no need to remember. Just at the final, we will get some equation. Just you have to remember that one only. No need to remember all these derivations. Just I am writing how the equation was obtained. Yes, see here, 1 by lambda is present here. 1 by lambda means reciprocal of wavelength. Once again, 1 by lambda means reciprocal of wavelength, that is called as wave number. Then we can write HC nu bar is equal to RH into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. So from this formula, what we can calculate? Yes, all of you know H means Planck's constant. It is a constant value. C means speed of light. It is a constant value. RH means Rydberg's constant. It is a constant value. N1 means lower orbit number. N2 means higher orbit number. All these are constants. So what we are going to derive, what we are going to determine? Nu bar. Nu bar means wave number of emitted spectral line. Once again, wave number of emitted spectral line can be calculated. So wave number of emitted spectral line, nu bar is equal to RH by HC into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. This is the final formula. Just simply you can remember. To remember anything, you have to by head. The formulas should be by headed. So nu bar, what is meant by nu bar? Nu bar means wave number of emitted spectral line. Wave number of emitted spectral line of hydrogen atom. Here we are discussing only about hydrogen atom. That is nu bar is equal to, once again, the same formula, RH by HC into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. Yes, my dear students, you will get it out. Sir, you are calculating the wave number. What are the units of wave number? Can anybody say what are the units of wave number? Wave number is the reciprocal of wavelength. Once again, wave number is the reciprocal of wavelength. Wavelength are having the units centimeters or meters. Then where number are having the units centimeter inverse or meter inverse? Sweta, correct answer. Centimeter inverse or meter inverse. So finally, I am writing the formula as nu bar is equal to RH by HC into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square, either centimeter inverse or meter inverse. Here, we know the values, constant values, RH value. What is RH value? In the last classes, we discussed. What is RH value? RH is equal to 2.18 into 10 to the power of minus 18 joules, Rydberg's constant. And H value, Planck's constant. Planck's constant 6.6256. Otherwise, 6.626 into 10 to the power of minus 34 joules a second. About this unit, I asked the question in the last exam. Still, so many students didn't answer properly. Please remember, Planck's constant, H is equal to 6.6256 or 6.626 into 10 to the power of minus 34 joules a second. And C means speed of light. Speed of light or velocity of light. 3 into 10 to the power of 8 meters per second. Per second is written as second inverse. So by substituting all these constant values, finally we will get the answer as nu bar is equal to 1.09677 into 10 to the power of 7. 1.09677 into 10 to the power of 10 to the power of value. Just a minute. Here RH value. See this RH value. RH value is having 10 to the power of minus 18. By H is having 10 to the power of minus 34 into C. C is having 10 to the power of 8. Yes, just once calculate it. Minus 18, minus 8. Minus 18, minus 8. That is minus 26. Minus 26 plus 34. That is plus 8. Right, correct. So finally, we will get the nu bar as nu bar is equal to 1.09677 into 10 to the power of 7 into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. Here the units are. Here the units are. Whether meter inverse or centimeter inverse means we are taking joules. Joule is a unit of SI unit. Then nu bar units are. Nu bar units are meter inverse. So this is the final equation you have to remember. What we calculated by the explanation of line spectrum of hydrogen. From the explanation of line spectrum of hydrogen, what we calculated? Nu bar. What is meant by nu bar? Wave number of emitted spectral line of hydrogen atom. Once again, wave number of emitted spectral line of hydrogen atom, nu bar is equal to 1.09677 into 10 to the power of 7 into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square meter inverse. So this is all about the explanation of line spectrum of hydrogen. Yes, already in the last classes, we discussed Bohr's theory is also having limitations. That means Bohr's theory is also not a perfect theory to explain the atomic structure or structure of atom. That's why another theory was proposed, that is quantum mechanical model of atom. The next atomic theory proposed is quantum mechanical model of atom. The next atomic theory proposed to explain the atomic structures of all the atoms is quantum mechanical model of atom. It was explained by using two concepts. The first concept is dual nature of matter. In the last very starting of the classes, we discussed that electromagnetic radiations are having dual nature, particle nature as well as wave nature. Once again, the electromagnetic radiations are having dual nature. Like that here, matter is also having dual nature. And the second one is Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So by using these two concepts, quantum mechanical model of atom was derived. So to understand this one, first we have to study about these two concepts. First one is dual nature of matter, and the second one is Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. That's dual nature. What is meant by dual nature? Having two different natures. Here, if we take any matter, suppose if we consider this shock piece, if we see this shock piece, if this shock piece is thrown, see me, observe me, if the shock piece is thrown, whether the shock piece which was thrown, whether travel in a straight line? Once again, my question, if a chalk piece or a stone is thrown into the space, whether that chalk piece or stone travel in a straight line? Okay, it is not a straight line. What is the path of that chalk piece? Or what is the path of that stone thrown into the space? Yes, it forms a curve. Very good answer. It forms a curve. So, this is a matter. You can see this matter. You can see this matter. This means macroscopic matter. Whatever the matter we are able to see with the naked eyes, that is macroscopic matter. But in the atoms, electrons are present. Of course, we can't see the atoms also. Suppose if the chunk piece is given, it is containing calcium, carbon, and oxygen. Can you see where the calcium is present? Where the oxygen is present? So, whatever the matter we can't see with naked eye, that is said to be as microscopic. So, matter is classified into two types. Macroscopic matter and microscopic matter. Chalk piece and myself, the laptop or anything, whatever we are seeing, that is the macroscopic matter. Once again, the chalk piece is thrown into the space. That means a macroscopic matter is thrown into the space. Of course, it is moving in the space to form a curve. That means that curve is having crest, but not a trough. If crest and trough both are there, that is said to be as a waveform. So macroscopic matters, when they are in motion, once again, when the macroscopic matters, when they are in motion, they are not going to exhibit a wave nature. The macroscopic matters are going to exhibit a particle nature, but not wave nature. Wave nature of macroscopic matters is negligible. But we are not discussing about macroscopic matters because we are discussing about structure of atom, that is microscopic. So when coming to the dual nature of matter, yes, first of all, we are saying about matter. Matter is of two types. That is macroscopic and microscopic. If the macroscopic matter is taken, it is going to have two natures, particle nature as well as wave nature. But the wave nature of macroscopic matter is negligible. Once again, the wave nature of macroscopic matter is negligible. Whereas in the case of microscopic matter, for example, if I take the electron, because the chemical reactions are due to transfer of electrons. Once again, the chemical reactions are due to transfer of electrons. So I'm studying about electron here. Electron is an example of microscopic matter. And electron, first of all, it is a particle. And electron is also having wave nature. So what is having? Electron is having particle nature as well as wave nature. This was proposed by de Broglie. If L is considered as silent, we can say it is as de Broglie. So pronunciation is different in different places. We can say it is as de Broglie or de Broglie. So I can call it as de Broglie. So de Broglie is going to say that microscopic matter, that is electrons like particles, microscopic matter, that is electron-like particles, they are having two natures. What are the two natures? Particle nature as well as wave nature. So for these microscopic particles, which are going to have dual nature, having two natures means simply they said to be as dual nature, then de Broglie calculated wavelength of the moving particles, that is microscopic particles. So the wavelength of the microscopic particles are calculated by the de Broglie, and the formula is given as lambda is equal to h by mb. Here, what is meant by lambda? Lambda means wavelength of moving matter. Wavelength of moving matter. Here, matter means microscopic, and m stands for mass of the moving matter, and v stands for, as all of you know, velocity of moving matter, and the formula is given as, once again, lambda is equal to h by mb. Yes, just a minute, I have to take the attendance. After that, I will continue the session. My dear students, if you are having the textbooks beside you when the class is going on, when you are listening to my class and seeing the textbook, you can understand the topic very easily. And after the completion of class, once again, go through the textbook. Please read the content in the textbook. And after that, read the question and answers from the Zivit material. If you can do all those things simultaneously, at the end, you can easily understand the MCQs, what we are going to discuss in the next classes. Anyhow, dual nature of matter, lambda was given. Lambda means wavelength of the moving matter was given by de Broglie, and it is calculated as lambda is equal to h by mb. Okay, mb means mass multiplied with velocity. Can anybody say what is the product? What is the product of mass and velocity? What is the product of mass and velocity? Right, correct. The product of mass and velocity is momentum. Momentum. So we can write the formula de Broglie wavelength. De Broglie wavelength lambda is equal to h by mb. Otherwise, simply we can write lambda is equal to h by p. Here p stands for momentum. So this is about a dual nature of matter. And my dear students, the problems are given in the textbook. Even solutions are also provided in the textbook. Please just go through the problems and solutions. Later in the MCQs part, I will discuss the problems regarding this dual nature of matter. Right, moving to the next topic. The topic is Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. How much time is there? Okay, fine. Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Heisenberg's uncertainty. Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Heisenberg is the name of the scientist. He is saying some uncertainty about microscopic particles. Microscopic particles. Yes. When you are traveling in a car, or in a train, or in a bus, or on a cycle, that is bicycle, when you are traveling, we can determine the exact position of that person who are traveling. We can determine the velocity of that bus. That means we can determine the exact position of that bus, exact velocity of that bus, because bus is a macroscopic matter. Once again, if we are traveling in a bus, we can determine the exact position of the bus with the help of the GPS. Once again, with the help of GPS, we can determine the exact position of the bus and exact velocity of the bus, because bus is a macroscopic matter. But coming to the microscopic particles, suppose if electron is taken around the nucleus, electron is continuously revolving. Suppose if it is considered as a nucleus, around the nucleus, electron is continuously revolving. Can you guess where the electron is exactly present? Once again, my question. When the electron is continuously revolving around the nucleus, can you guess where the electron is exactly present? Yes, we can't guess the exact position of electron, because electron being a microscopic particle, it is not possible to determine the exact position of electron. That was explained by Heisenberg. When exact position of electron is not known, exact velocity of electron cannot be determined. Once again, when the exact position of electron is not known, we can't determine the exact velocity of electron. So according to the scientists Heisenberg, whenever microscopic particles are in motion, it is impossible to determine the exact position and exact velocity of electron. That was known as Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Yes, I'm writing the statement. It is impossible to determine the exact position and exact velocity of microscopic particles simultaneously . This was proposed by Heisenberg. So this is the statement of Heisenberg uncertainty principle. Of course, in the textbook, if we read the statement, little bit wording may be different, but the content is same. Please don't go for wording. Please just go through the content. So once again, the content here is, suppose if an electron is going to observe around the nucleus, it is not possible to determine the exact position of electron. It is not possible to determine the exact velocity of electron, because it is a microscopic particle. We can't determine simultaneously the exact position and velocity of electron, right? When the exact position and velocity of electron is not known, it is not possible to determine the exact momentum of electron, because momentum is indicated by P. P is equal to momentum of electron, P is equal to mv. What is uncertain? Velocity of electron is uncertain. When the velocity of electron is uncertain, momentum of the electron is also uncertain. So this was explained by the Heisenberg. Yes. Now the conclusion is, according to Niels Bohr, how the electron is going to revolve in the atom? Text me your answer. According to Niels Bohr, how the electron is going to revolve in an atom? Waiting for your response. According to Niels Bohr, how the electron is going to revolve in an atom? Yes, correct. In a circular path. Yes, correct. In a circular path. Because Niels Bohr considered electron as a particle only. Once again, the statement. Niels Bohr considered electron as a particle only. If electron is considered as a particle, then the electron can revolve around the nucleus in circular path. But according to de Broglie, according to the scientist de Broglie, which particles we are going to consider here? Microscopic particles, if we consider the microscopic particles and their motion. Microscopic particles are having
or microscope matter is having particle nature as well as wave nature. When particle nature is there, that electron can revolve, the electron can revolve around the nucleus in a circular path. Yes, it is correct. But when electron is considered as a wave, when the electron is considered as a wave, what is the path of electron? When the electron is considered as a wave, the path of electron around the nucleus is not circular. Once again, the statement: when the electron is having the wave nature, the path of the electron around the nucleus is not a circular path. Now the path is like this, having crest and trough, crest and trough. So like this, the path of electron will be present according to de Broglie and according to Heisenberg. Now tell me, what is the exact path of electron? Path of electron is also called as trajectory. The trajectory or the path of electron. What is the exact path of electron? Can anybody guess whether the electron can revolve in a circular path or the electron can revolve in a wave path? What is the exact path of electron? Yes, it is uncertain. The path of electron, around the nucleus, is uncertain. This was proposed by Heisenberg in an